Saints of God, God bless you tonight. Thank you. Love you tonight. Streamers, love you too. Love y'all. All right. As far as I know, and don't, whenever I say as far as I know, that's to be taken very lightly. I only have one more form left to submit to some other people. One left. I've been sending stuff over there like, you, Eric, you can't wait. Anyway, I think there's one more form I have to turn in this week. And that, I think, should bring an announcement shortly. Short announcement. Don't have any announcement tonight other than the Holy Ghost here for you tonight. That one I have an announcement for. That's exactly the truth. The Holy Ghost is here. He's got everything Jesus has got. He's got the blood. He's got the broken body of Christ. The Holy Ghost is the man. And he's going to show up here at this altar tonight, and you're going to get a touch from God. It's that simple. Nobody ever comes here to see me. What for? Just a regular person like everybody else. So I'm out of it. That's how you got to look at it. You're out of it. And it's the Holy Ghost or bust. And that's it. Yes, sir. It's the Holy Ghost or bust. All right, our next seminar will be a good one. This one's always very popular. I made lots of money over the years as a counselor, working with people that had emotional illnesses. They're rampant in our society, and they're rampant in the church. They're as common as anything you could ever see, and they are curable. They are curable. I've seen them cured with my own eyes. I didn't cure them, but I've seen God cure them. Okay? So that'll be our next seminar at the end of February. Bless you. As you know, we're on the radio every day here in the valley, every morning. Excuse me, I got a little throat thing tonight. It'll be gone in a couple minutes. I'm on every morning on these stations right here, and I'm on in the afternoons at 5:30. I'm always on the internet on the radio, on soundcloud.com/hardcore-christianity. If you'd like to help the ministry out, you could do that financially. But it won't cost you anything if you just switch over from Google to Good Search. Put our charity name in there, Hardcore Christianity. They'll donate money to our ministry every time you search the internet for a lot of, for good things, which is what you always do. You're not searching the internet for bad things. Didn't get any amens on that, so I think I'll switch the next seminar to Perverts in America. But while you're searching the internet, they will send me a check every November. And I usually use it on a utility bill or something like that. I don't take a salary in the ministry, so everything that comes in goes to pay what I got to pay and the building fund or whatever I'm doing. Okay? That's the way I look at it. There's seems unfair for me to ask someone else to sacrifice for God when I'm not doing it. See, I'm not a TV preacher. I'm not on TV. I'm on YouTube. Yeah, I see the envy, deep envy everywhere on YouTube. Good search. Thank you. Hardcore Christianity. Tonight's teaching will be on a YouTube channel 4, which is our House of Healing channel there. The channel number 1 is our deliverance training channel. If you want to get into the healing or deliverance ministry, at some time in the future. Wow, what a great spot to park. Okay. There's 18 sessions. You know, it's going to take some work on your part to do it, though. Yeah. It's not one of those click, click, click things you're in the ministry. That you get that at Bible college. Take these classes and go in the ministry. Okay, that crap doesn't work. You got to have the anointing. You got to have grounded in God's word. You got to repent of your sin. You got to be a fighter. The Bible college thing is not working. That does not work. It's not all bad. There's a lot of good people in Bible college. I'm talking about getting the healing and deliverance ministry. That's not Bible college. That's a horse of a different color. All right? And the orange, the green offering buckets sitting back there by that big guy right there. I'm highlighting his shirt. And thank you for your donations. I think I've got all my donation receipts already out, except one person, as far as I know. Tonight's Bible study. Impossible. Have any of you... Where's that hand, Mike? Is that thing on? Hey, can I have that for just a second? Vivian had it. Oh, she didn't take it. Once you've been Vivianized, you're never the same. Anybody here, think about it for a second. Have you ever faced a totally impossible situation? Just think about that for a second before you raise your hand. Totally, absolutely impossible to fix. No possible way. No, nothing. Not luck, not good, nothing. Anybody in this section? Yes. Who? What was it? Okay. You had one?
Yes.
What happened to you?
Right arm was paralyzed for 11 months from a motorcycle accident.
Your right arm was paralyzed? What was wrong with it? Oh, you had nerve damage in your right arm for 11 months from a motorcycle accident?
Yeah.
You laid it down?
No, I found an abandoned car in the freeway at midnight. I was living by sight, not by faith.
You found an abandoned car?
Yes.
I think I'm missing something out of that story. Did you hit the car?
Yeah.
Okay.
No, flat tire, fast,
and I found it at 80. Oh, okay. That'll do it. Then what happened to your arm?
Did, the direction I
should have,
came back.
Did you go to physical therapy?
Yeah, I was involved with that. They were doing electric therapy, doing needles, and okay. My arm, nothing worked. And just prayers and patience.
Okay.
The doctors didn't expect anything to come back. Just wait.
All right, in this section? There's one.
Well, one time, after all my money had been stolen and I was not homeless anymore, but my car just was in such need of repair that it wasn't going to run. And so I said to the Lord, well, you're just going to have to take care of it because I don't have any money to fix it. So that night, this is Dallas, the storm came through, lightning hit the tree in the front yard, and it totaled my car. And the insurance paid for another one.
So September 3rd, 1995, I was bitten by a 4 foot 11 inch diamondback rattlesnake.
Ooh.
Gave me a full ounce of venom in my index finger. The venom went up my arm, down my chest, and I went in anaphylactic shock. My buddy and I and his wife were 28 miles out in the desert. And he dukes a hazard me all the way through the desert. What's amazing is, and this is impossible, but 3 days prior, my insurance went into effect at work. My best friend's wife got a cell phone from her work 2 weeks prior to me being bit and was able to call the ambulance to meet us in Maricopa at the Circle K. They got me to the Circle K. They took me by ambulance to, I don't know if it was Sierra Vista or if it was one of the medical centers out there. They gave me 2 doses of antivenom. I went into anaphylactic shock so bad, I convulsed and they said I died and they had to bring me back. They got me to Good Sam with the helicopter. And Dr. Mickey Kunkel, the top toxicologist here in the state of Arizona, told my parents that I've seen a lot of bad bites, but this one's the worst and I don't think he'll make it over the next 24 hours. If you have a God, I'd start praying. And for that 24 hours, it was impossible. My blood platelet count went down to 3,000. I started internally hemorrhaging, and I was dying. all my organs were failing. And after 68 vials of horse serum, it wasn't Crofab, it was horse serum that time, I had the worst serum sickness ever seen. They put me in the New England Journal of Medicine, and they had never seen anything like it, and I came out of that through prayer. It was the only thing that got me out.
My impossible miracle was I was just filling my car up with gas. I drove up to the little station where, and I put my credit card in, and it read it, and then I tried to pump gas into it, and nothing would happen. I was like, okay, so this one's not working. So I went to another one where I saw somebody had just filled up there, and same thing happened again. It wouldn't pump any gas, but it would read my card. Thought, okay, Lord, thank you so much. You've saved me from some bad gas at this station or something like that. And I went a couple miles down the road, same thing happened again. And I said, okay, Lord, what's up? And I felt the Lord say at that point, this is your Peter stepping out of the moment, out of the boat moment. The moment you think I can't run this car without gas, that's the moment you're going to be stranded on the highway. So I went 5 days with... 4 days with no gas in the car, 1 day with the empty part, almost empty part of the tank. And then the miracle ended when unbelief got in my car. And it wasn't from me, it was my kids. So, praise God.
When I was about 15 years old, I used to dirt bike ride. I'm from Los Angeles. And they had like a lot of little hills and places that you could go and, you know, dirt bike. And so we were up in the mountains one time, me and a friend, and we saw this place where you could take your dirt bike and just ride down and hit a dune. And, you go jumping through there and, you know, just all the way down the mountain. So when we saw it, we went all the way to the top. We said, yeah, okay, we'll hit this. It's going to be nice. We went all the way to the top of the mountain. We came down real fast. And I came down, and I forgot which one I should take. Which one is it? I'm doing like 35, 40 miles an hour down this hill. All of a sudden, I didn't know which one it was. I hit this dune, and I must have flew up in the air about 50 feet. And the bike, I just let go of the bike. The bike just flew one direction. I was flying a different direction, and I just knew I was going to get ready to break my neck and probably get killed. I flew backwards about 50 feet in the air, and I just knew I was getting ready to just die. And all of a sudden, when I landed on the softest grass patch that you could ever. It was like jumping on your bed. I couldn't believe. I just boom. What? And then the bike just flew right by me. Bam! And I was just stunned. 50 feet in the air backwards, flipping over backwards, and I land. I was like, the Lord must have was there for me that day. I mean, it was amazing. Praise the Lord.
So several years ago, I owned my own small business, and I'd come to the point where I'd had some illness and had some different problems, and I looked out and I saw no possible way that I would be in business in 2 months, and also just truly understand that I was going to die, and I saw no way out of any of it. So, sorry. So I fell on my face. And I gave it to God, and I gave it to Jesus, and prayed through it, started talking with Father every day, changed, examined, made changes where it was needed, and I, still to this day, I don't know how. I made it through the 2 months, let alone the last 3.5 years.
Wow. Well done.
Back in 1998, I had a swollen eye. Finally went to an optometrist who sent me to an ophthalmologist who did so they discovered that I had cancer in this left eye behind ear. It was a lymphoma, and so they did all kinds of treatments on that, and then they found that I had it at the same stuff in my right lung, and the oncologist was sitting there in front of me about 3 feet away telling me that I needed to put everything together. He did all my plans together, plan my funeral and so forth, because I'd probably be gone in 3 months to a year. So, and while he was talking to me, it was like he was on a TV screen. He wasn't real. And I had a voice in the back of my head that says, don't pay attention to this guy, because this is not what will kill you. And I'm still here.
Fell off the roof of a house in 2010. I crushed my heels, my ankles were broken, and the doctor, I went through x-ray. By the time I got to the hospital, I prayed for God to give me a scripture that I could put my faith in, because I knew God would heal me. So by the time I got in the hospital, I told him, do not put any medicine in my body. And I went through x-ray with no pain medicine. The doctor said it looked like he'd drop eggs from chest high on the sidewalk. He said that's what my heels look like. And when the doctor come in after looking at the x-rays, he was so mad. He was playing God. He said, there's nothing we can do for you. You have no insurance. It's a difficult surgery. He said, no one is going to perform this surgery. He said, I'm one of the best orthopedic surgeons around, and I won't touch your feet. That was his exact words. So I think he wanted me to beg him. So after he left out of my, he said, do you remember my name? I said, no, sir. He said, that was a test. I took his business card and threw it towards the table. I didn't even look at it. And when he walked out of the room, I started praying. I said, Lord, you hear what the doctors are saying. I could sure use that scripture. Ring. It was a pastor of a church. He said, Frank, he said, I heard about your accident. He said, I went straight to God. He said, God gave me two things specifically for you. He said, first, don't listen to a word them doctors are saying. He said, God is going to heal you with no surgery. He said, second, he said, he gave me a scripture for you to stand on. And I could feel the Holy Spirit. It was Luke 8:50, Jairus' daughter dying and Jesus on his way. Luke 8:49 says that a servant comes, said that the girl was dead, trouble not the master. And he said, and then Luke 8:50, Jesus heard it, said, fear not, believe only, and she shall be made whole. He said, you put that in front of you, you say, I fear not, I believe only. He said, and God's going to heal your feet. I was so excited. So then my family was trying to have me committed to an insane asylum. So they found somebody to do the surgery, because my little sister was calling and cussing and hollering, and they found somebody to do the surgery. And then the doctor, the next time he come in my room, he didn't even look like the same person. He said we found somebody right here at UAB to perform the surgery. He said, great orthopedic surgeon. And he said, he called his number, called the secretary, set up an appointment. He said, and they're going to fix your feet. This time I think you want me to cheer, you know. After he walked out, the nurse comes in and they give me this bag of saline, and she's going to put medicine in my IV without even talking to me. I said, I told you don't put no medicine in my body. She said, things has changed. They found somebody to do the surgery. So she said, you might as well file for temporary disability, because if you're out of work for a year, you're eligible. She said, I'm real familiar with your injuries, and you will not be able to walk for a year. And then she got up there with that syringe. I don't know what it was. I said, stop, I'm not having the surgery. So they bought me a wheelchair and said, you're free to go. And I wheeled myself out. And 1 week to the exact day after I left out of the hospital, I was in a little church service. They prayed for me. I thought it was going to be like TV and I was just going to get up and walk out of the chair. And that didn't happen. So I just kept saying, I fear not, I believe only, you know, I shall be made whole. And the day after, this was a young woman, as my daughter was pushing me out of the meeting, a young woman I didn't know walked up and said, God gave me a vision while they were praying for you. She said, in the next couple of days, you're going to feel them shattered bones coming back together. She said, first your right foot and then your left. And I said, praise God, somebody's listening, you know. The next day, I'm laying there with my feet propped up, and it felt like a hand reached inside my foot and squeezed my heels back together. I could feel the swelling going out of my foot. And it was my right foot, and I could feel this itchy burn in the bone. And then when he got finished, I looked over there, and then there it was, my bones coming back together.
Last call for miracles.
All right, I was for five years I was a meth and heroin addict, and I couldn't get any sobriety time at all. I couldn't get anything longer than 2 weeks, and I have 7.5 months today, thanks to God.
Right on.
You want me to give a testimony? I was rear-ended by a car, and it injured my C4 and C5. And as a result of it, I was having severe nerve pains going down my arm, and I couldn't raise my arm past here. I was taking probably 10 Percocet a day. And I went to a neurosurgeon, and they said, you need immediate surgery. And I was like, okay, I need to get a second opinion. I wasn't walking with the Lord at that time. Was I walking with the Lord? I think I was. Yeah, I was. And so they said, you need a second. So I wanted a second opinion. So I got a second opinion. They said, you need immediate surgery. And when I went to the surgeon, he said, we need to cut your throat, move over your voice box and your vocal cords, and there's a big chance that you'll never talk again. Well, that wasn't happening. So I was like, okay, never talk again, have no pain. I was like, nah, I gotta talk. Like, so I just remember the Lord said, get the elders of the church to pray for you and anoint you with oil and you will be healed. And I just believed that, you know, God just had to heal me. So I got them to pray for me. And over 7 days, my arm just started going up more and more and more until the next day it was up.
When did you start talking again? Oh, wow. Now, streamers, all them testimonies were exhibitions of the Spirit of God. None of them people healed themselves. None of them people had a chance, had a hope in hell of getting a healing. And then he showed up. And people get healed because he brings the broken body of Jesus. He lays that body on your body. Your body heals. That's how he does it. That's how it works. How exactly he does that, I don't know. I don't care. I just want him to do it. There's impossibilities everywhere, right? 1 Samuel 17, this was totally impossible. King David offers to go out and face Goliath. Remember that story? Oh, that was something. The whole nation of Israel was quaking in fear. Had I been there, I'd been quaking with them. He offers to go out and fight him, and Saul goes, okay, we don't have anybody else volunteering, so we will let you do it. So let's do the best we can to help you face Goliath. So what Saul did, he gave him his armor. It says here, 1 Samuel 17, he put his helmet on him. Now remember, he's not an adult. He's a watching the sheep. Now he's probably an early teenager or something. He's not a fully grown. So none of this stuff is fitting. So he puts the hat on, drops down over his eyes. He puts the brass on his head. He gives him his coat. It's sinking clear down. He's having trouble moving with it. And he hands him his sword. This thing's too big for him. He doesn't know how to use a sword. All he knows how to do is watch sheep and use his slingshot, which he was an expert at. And he said, I can't do this. Now, if you notice on some of these testimonies we just had, when you need a miracle from God and you're facing a total impossibility, other people's theories, concepts, theology, dogma aren't going to work for you. You may have to go directly to God to get the answer for your impossible situation. When you have an impossible situation, everybody gives you all kinds of advice. Did you hear them? Going to the doctor, everybody had given them a lot of advice. We need to do this and go there. Take that, shoot this, surgery that. That's them talking. And that's Saul talking. Sometimes you got to go directly to God when you're facing an impossible situation. Should you never talk to anybody? Oh, of course not. You should always get advice from intelligent people. That's Christian. That's common sense. Obviously, you get consultations and everything. I'm talking about when you're facing an impossible situation. A situation that cannot be fixed under any circumstances. Blown out heels. Torn rotator cuffs. Okay? He says, I can't wear this outfit out there. This isn't me. See, God tailors all of his gifts and all of his anointings to each individual person. The kooky charismatics and the crazy prophetics, they run around trying to impart their anointing into someone. Stupid. That person's not you. You're not that person. They're not you. God has a special anointing just for you. When it comes to the Holy Ghost, unlike OJ, the glove fits. That fits just perfect for you. Saul's glove, now it's OJ. It don't fit. I can't wear these, he says. Then went out the champion of the camp of the Philistines, Goliath of Gath. He was this big, over 10 feet tall, 6 cubits in a span. What's a span? Span. What's a cubit? A lot of screwed up construction back then. Why? Your cubit's not the same size as mine. Okay. So when you're working on a construction job, you got to find out who the guy was that was used for the cubits. Otherwise, your house is going to be looking like that. But if you take a cubit, an Egyptian cubit, say, let's say around 22 inches or something like that, nobody knows exactly, but I mean, that seems to be approximately it. This dude's over 10 feet tall. Is he a skinny little guy from like Angola? No. Here it describes what he was wearing on his head, what his coat of mail, his armor he had on. The weight of his coat was 5,000 shekels. We'll go over that in a minute. His greaves were on both of his legs and his knees. Those were your shin guards, your knee guard, like catchers wear, so to speak. He had shoulder armor on. He had a spear and a staff that was 600 shekels. Unbelievable. Well, I looked all this stuff up just for fun to try to get a visual picture of Goliath, because the only person I could relate to was when I was young. I saw a wrestling match one time. I think I was in my 20s, late 20s. I saw Andre the Giant. I'm not even making this up. P- pick up a guy who weighed 300 pounds like he was picking up a pillow and throw that dude over the top rope into the crowd. I don't know how he did it. Just 300-pound guy. That's the only person I knew I could relate to. To me, he was a Nephilim. And I think he kind of looked like one. He was huge. I think he was 7'5" or something like that. I think he was like 450 or something. This guy, that guy was big and strong. Strong. Andre the Giant would have been at the Philistine daycare center. This guy, I looked up the weights on all the things he was just wearing was the weight of the guy Andre threw out the ring. 300 by my adding, assuming I added it right, and that's a gift of faith assumption. I'm going to say 307 pounds of armor he had on, hauling around. This guy was huge. These, I believe, are 8 feet ceilings. How tall are these? These are 8 feet ceilings. He was 2 feet taller than that, wearing over 300 pounds of armor. This guy's bad news, to say the least. Big time bad news. Here's actual, and in antiquities, they discovered some of this stuff. Here's what one of these coats kind of looked at. They would sew metal on the cloth to protect them in battle. Here's a spearhead from a Roman spear. So the one he had was 5 or 6 times bigger than that one, because it didn't fit on a spear, javelin. It fit on a weaver's beam. The weaver's beams were much bigger, as you know, because they're rolling the thread and the cloth over it. This thing was like huge. This guy was a monster, to say the least. He's big. Here's some actual swords they found during the period of Rome, and his swords would have been twice this size based on that description. There's the greaves, the thing they wore on their ankles, their knees, protecting them in battle. All he had was this thing, his slingshot. You say, well, was it a lucky shot? No. It was a combination of two things. This slingshot's very important for you spiritually. David had spent hundreds of hours out in the pasture, jacking around with his sheep, practicing this skill. And that was a common skill for people back then, and they could hit a nickel on that wall. They were expert marksmen with those slingshots. Literally, and they used them to defend the sheep against wild animals. They were dangerous. You could put somebody's eye out or kill somebody if you hit them just right with one of these shots. Secondly, the Holy Ghost, in my opinion, must have had a little hand on that thing flying through the air. I really believe that. The Bible doesn't say that, but in my mind, I think that's what I believe. I think that. What's God trying to tell me through just a simple sling there? He's trying to tell me that you do your part, Mike, and then I'll do my part. And you will face an impossible situation no more. You have to do your part, which God will not do. You can't do His part. This is teamwork. Pew-sucking type Christians who eviscerate on the pew and sit there for decades never get a miracle, never get an anointing. Why? Because they're not doing their part. The anointing's there, the miracles are there, the blessings are there. But they are super glued down. So nothing ever happens. David had to do his part every day. Bang! He was the best at it. And he was so good at it and had so much faith that he didn't pick up one stone, he picked up
five
stones. Why?
Five brothers.
Yes. he was going to systematically go down and wipe out all five of them. Can you imagine that? Didn't need to. Once God gave him this impossible miracle, this was impossible. They slaughtered him. You notice in every one of those testimonies, the person was doing something before the miracle came. See that guy there? He called, he prayed to the Lord, he said, I need a scripture. A pastor called him, gave him the scripture, he took it in, that triggered the moving of the Spirit. Notice he did something. Not because he earned it, but he did it by faith. As preachers say, they stepped out on faith. Sometimes it's a little step for a miracle, sometimes it's a big one, but there's something for you to do that you haven't done that's blocking your miracle. Oh, these two guys were shot. Can you imagine living back then? Well, you can if you live now in an undeveloped country. If you go to the Sudan or something, you're back in biblical times. There's no economy back then. There's no jobs. There's no employment agencies. There's no place to work. Everybody either worked in agriculture or labor or domestic work. There was no place to go. So if you were blind, born blind or became blind, your life was shot. It was over. You had no options. Your situation was totally impossible. Completely impossible. The only way to earn money, if you're blind, was to beg. You are a professional beggar. As I got off the freeway tonight, right over here on I-17, we're stopped in line, and I'm on the inside lane, and a guy in a wheelchair rolling down the side. He's got a little, what's that Mexican dog called, the little ones?
Chihuahua.
He's got a chihuahua tied up down by the street, but he's rolling down the side here for the car. So I'm scooping it down here. I get a Bible track out. I'm scooping in my thing for the money. I get my scoop out and my Bible. He comes by with his hat. I put it in there. God bless you. We love you. We'll pray for you. I'm looking at the dog down there. As soon as this guy in the wheelchair starts to move toward my car, the dog starts panicking. This guy looks like somebody's dug him up. He hasn't had a bath. I have no idea when. He was filthy. He is unshaven, unkept, dirty. His wheelchair was dirty. Everything about this guy was dirty. Okay? That little dog back there thought this guy was the greatest living being in the universe. And as soon as he started to roll away from him, the dog is thinking, he's leaving forever. He starts jumping back and forth. Then he starts looking around. Then he starts barking. Now he must have rolled down that freeway several times that day. Right? Are chihuahuas intelligent? Yeah, that's what I thought. But that dog, every time that guy started to leave that dog, panic set in on him. He goes down behind us. Nobody else gives him anything, so he rolls backwards. He's got an electric wheelchair. He's rolling down. Pretty good driver. Going pretty fast backwards. I couldn't have done it. I would have drifted over the edge into the... And the dog sees him coming back. Stops panicking and starts jumping with excitement. Wagging that tail like he had never seen him before. And the thought came to me, that is how the prodigal son thing went. when he saw the son coming down the road there. The dad got off the porch, giggling and wagging his tail. But these guys didn't have anybody. They had to do what that guy in the wheelchair does. They had to beg all day. And these guys did not lose everything because they were blind. No, they still had a family. They had somebody that cared somewhere. And look what they do. There's no possible way to get healed of blindness. Even today, it's almost impossible. Certain types, I guess, are curable. The vast majority of them still can't even cure it. They don't heal you of blindness in the 21st century. They just give you a dog. Instead of getting healed, you get a dog. If you got the insurance. If you don't have any insurance, you don't even get a dog. You got to go get your own chihuahua. Jesus is walking down the street and they're following him. And that's difficult to do if you're blind, but then they start yelling at him. They can't see him. So if you can't see somebody, you can't do any body language reading. You don't know what they're doing, whether he's listening or not. He's not saying anything. You don't know exactly where he is. Plus, there's all kinds of other people ahead of you following him. So these guys are, this is a tough road. What are they doing there? They're learning like David did. They're learning their part, and then they're waiting for God to do his part. When they came to the house, what house it was, I don't know, the blind man came to Jesus. They followed him all the way to the home he was going to. And Jesus turns around and says to them, "Do you believe I'm able to do this?" Now, why did he say that? He only said it for our purposes. He already knew they did. That's the Greek word pistuo, and it means to believe without doubting and without questioning and having no doubts and no unbelief, period. And it also is a verb, Greek verb, which means you step out on that faith before you get the miracle. Pistuo requires you to step out first before the miracle comes. If you can believe, all things are possible to him that believeth. Pistuo is used in that verse twice. What does that mean? You have to step first, which triggers the moving of the Spirit. Sitting and waiting No, that's for church people. They sit and wait. If you can step out, do you actually believe? He already knew that because they had been following him for several blocks or whatever it was, and they're blind. He already knew they believed it. He just said that for us. And they said the obvious. They're both stating the obvious. Of course they believed. They'd been following him for blocks. Well, Jesus then said, according to your, not mine. People that are facing impossible situations, the devil tells them to go find somebody to pray for them. So they roam around hunting for faith healers. They're on a faith healer hunt. Never knowing that they never needed to leave their home. Your faith not mine. Am I reading it right?
Yes.
I think I am. And then what happened? Oh, boom. In our society, you get a dog, but if you have faith, that guy there. What was he saying? Lord, I don't want a dog. It's not that you don't like dogs. I mean, they're good dogs. He had an impossible situation. He needed healed. Oh, boy. This is the worst one of them all. You know why? He lost his family, and he was all alone. You know, they took a survey not too long ago. I've seen several of them. The greatest fear a human being has is being alone. Even people that like to be alone reach a point where they need to go see somebody. They're alone for a certain amount of time, and then they got to go. Human beings are built socially. And when they're all alone, that's the greatest fear. This guy had the worst disability of them all. When Jesus came down from the mountain, many people greeted him there, and there came a leper worshiping him. And he said, Lord, if you want to, you could make me clean. Now here, the guy's risking life and limb to come for help here. Happen to notice that? Lepers lost everything in their society. Literally everything. This guy probably had a wife and kids. He probably had a job. Probably came home from work one day. You know how that works. Hey, what's that spot on your back of your neck, Jacob? What spot? You got a spot back there. I noticed that a couple days ago. What is that spot? I don't know what it is, honey. How are the kids? We need to have that spot checked. That happens thousands of times a week here in Arizona. Because we have what?
Skin cancer.
Ugh, skin cancer bad here because of the... Yes, it gets hot here, folks. Yeah, when you come to visit the House of Healing, I'm feeling inspiration right now. Come during the winter. Because if you come to see me during the summer, wow, is it going to be hot here. And I mean, it gets hot here. And people have little spots pop up on their bodies, right? I remember I used to go to my GP and he'd open this drawer. I don't know if the guy was a real doctor or not, but he'd pull out this lamp. Have you ever seen one of those lamps? What do they call them? They're blue. They shine blue. UV lamp. And he'd take my clothes off. Or I mean, I took them off. And then he'd go like that. He'd scan my body with this blue lamp. Okay? It wasn't a sexual thing. It was medical. He's scanning me. Because he said this light, or this whatever he's using, would highlight if you had a carcinoma of any kind. It would have a different color on your body. I didn't know that. He would scan me and look over, all over the place. Well, I didn't have UV lights back then. Somebody must have seen it. It must have popped up somewhere. Back then, things were very different than they are here, right? That was kind of an uncivilized world, in effect. Bacteria and germs were not known like we have now, and leprosy was a major problem in this society because there was so much filth around. People had public toilets. They used the public toilets in town. There was a lot of things that weren't sanitary, washing hands, different things, cleansing utensils, stuff like that. People got sick a lot back then. unclean spirits of infirmity were huge in Jesus' ministry. He was flooded with people who were physically ill from diseases and illnesses, flooded with them. And it was all because much of it was from bad sanitation. Well, this guy here, he's in deep trouble now. He's lost his wife. He lost his kids. He lost his home. He had to leave his home, go to the Valley of the Lepers. He had to leave town, and to leave society, and to leave all of his friends. He had to leave everybody. The only people he knew were other sick lepers. Even other sick people couldn't be around him because leprosy is contagious. If you touch someone, you could catch it. To save your family, you had to leave. You left to save their lives if they hadn't already been infected. Secondly, if you came back into town back then, you usually got stoned. They don't want people running around town with leprosy. You aren't supposed to be in town. The only way to exterminate somebody safely is to throw a rock at them. Now it's a drive-by. Back then it was rocks. You'd get killed if you came into town. So this guy's situation is quite remarkable, to say the least. It took a lot of guts to come for help. Oh, man. I want you to learn something tonight. Man, some Christians are so spiritually lazy, they won't come for help. Here's what happens. The devil works out a psychiatric profile on each person. And then he buffaloes them. The spirits put thoughts in their minds, and he brings other people to them to give them false information. And he gives them this information that causes them to kind of become a recluse spiritually. And he teaches them that that's okay, that God's going to heal them. All you got to do is just kind of sit here and do nothing. Just keep waiting and be patient. He'll quote some scriptures about how you are to wait on the Lord and be patient. And before you know it, the disease has progressed to a certain point where now they're in deep trouble. Yes, cancer, blindness. Some diseases the devil can't just give you like that. That's the way he'd like to do it. He'd just like to kill you like that, but he can't. So he infects you with something, and it takes time to kill you. So he's got to stall you out. So he's got to give you a bunch of religious mumbo jumbo to get you to just stay there, sit, keep your faith, keep trusting the Lord. Hang in there, just sit right there and don't do anything. God will come to you, right? Remember the angel that came to Jacob? Oh, he'll quote scripture to you, yeah, telling you about angels coming to help you. And pretty soon, before you know it, that disease clicks a little further down. And now they're in deep trouble. Then he'll tell them, listen, put your name on a prayer list somewhere. Yeah. This group, this internet group, that church, have them put you on their prayer list. And then these people will pray for you. But just stay here. Stay right here. You don't need to do anything. Just keep your faith up. God's going to heal you. You'll be fine. As the sickness keeps going a little further, a little further. They're on the prayer chain now. You got hundreds of people praying for you. Oh, that's great. No problem. Keep your faith up. You'll be fine. They get off the prayer chain. Because they're healed? No, they died. Most people who are terminally ill on a prayer chain die. If you go through these healings in the New Testament and you read them slowly, kind of looking at the human nature of it, you can receive tremendous revelations. This story here is one of the most powerful stories in all the Bible. What that man did to get to God was phenomenal. What are you doing to get to God that's phenomenal? Don't answer that yet. In this leper's mind, his entire life had gone to hell in a handbasket. And when that happens, the devil gives you another backup plan. Here's what it is. Negative thoughts. When things are going bad, he comes to you with a series of negative thoughts and implants them in your mind, along with these false, you can get healed this way thoughts. As each method you use to get healed fails, he, like a kid on a teeter-totter, ramps up the negativity. He starts to tell you in your mind, man, you're in trouble. God doesn't want to heal you. God doesn't heal everyone. You know that. And he'll quote names. You'll remember names of people who died. They didn't get healed. He'll build his case, not in court, in your mind. Once he builds his case in your mind and wins it, you then have lost your mind. He then owns it. He had this dying leper living in chronic negativity. He knew he was going to die. He knew there was no cure. He was in an impossible situation. And the devil's talking to him while he decides to go to the Lord. Yes, somebody in the valley of the leper said, hey, the Messiah's here. The rest of the lepers stayed there. This guy goes, wait a minute. I got to make one last run. What was he thinking about? In his mind, he had his kids in there. I don't know my kids now. Where's my wife? Where's my family? Where's my life? He's got that back there. You see, the devil actually gets sick people to develop a mentality of dying. No, literally, I'm making this up. He actually gives you a series of thoughts designed to get you to give up. And the sicker you get, the more he pushes those thoughts and ramps them up. Pretty soon, if he gets your mind, he's got your body. This leper said, I've got to make a run for it. I'm going to try. I think the Holy Ghost was talking to him too. I think he heard a thought like, what do you got to lose? He hauls himself out of the Valley of Lepers, heads into town, everybody looking at him with nothing but negativity. He's all alone as usual, the thing people hate the most. He finally gets there and there's one demonic thought in his mind. It's still there and it comes out in this verse. He's got one thought there. He knows God can heal him. See, he grew up in the synagogue. He read the stories of the Red Sea, Elijah. I mean, he'd heard all them stories. He'd been in the synagogue all of his life. He knew God could heal. He knew the story of Naaman. He got healed of leprosy. He knew God could heal him, but in his miserable condition, with his miserable life, he wasn't sure he wanted to heal him. See the difference there? God can do anything. That doesn't help. Does it? It doesn't help anybody. If God can do anything, that's not helping me. Is it? That's him. I need something for me. So he asked him, he said, if you want to, you could make me clean. I know you can do it. This poor guy is just like all of us. I love this leper. Because I've got faith here, and then I got a little doubt there. Then I got some faith here, and I got a little doubt over there. See, this is going good. I need to work on that. This is good. I need to improve that area. I'm like that leper. He's got this going, but this back here is just a little off. Jesus put forth his hand and touched him, saying, what? Why did he touch him there? I don't exactly know, but my guess is seeing all these people I've seen healed in counseling sessions over the years, I think he touched him because he knew he was all alone. I think the touch wasn't for the leprosy. We already had that in the bag. Him coming in, like the blind man, already had that healing in the bag. But this poor leper had something missing in here. That was the reason the devil got him to ask that question. See, people who are alone and suffer from loneliness don't think other people care for them. They don't think others want to help them. They know they can. They've got the money, they've got the position, they've got the power, they've got whatever. But they don't think they want to help them. Jesus didn't touch him to heal the leprosy. He could have spoken that. In fact, did many times in other healings. Just spoke and they were healed. The centurion, for example, go. The Syrian woman, go. No. This dying leper with a broken heart, a lost family, living constantly alone, needed more than a healing. He needed his soul healed. That's why he touched him. Not for leprosy. What was he really saying? Father was touching him. Father wasn't there. Oh, yes, he was. Jesus said, I only do those things I see Father doing. He saw through the gift of knowledge, Father looking at that leper with tears in his eyes. He saw Father reaching out, not for the leprosy, for his broken heart. Family gone, kids gone, money gone, career gone, life gone, health gone, everything gone. Nothing left for him, nothing. Father had tears in his eyes. I don't want to just heal him of leprosy. That's not enough for me. Father said, that's not enough, son. Son, he saw Father reaching for that dying leper. And mind you, this person had no social standing of any kind. He was at the bottom of life. He was an unimportant person. Oh, he was shunned by everybody, a total and complete loser. But not in the spirit world, he wasn't. Oh, Father reached for him. Then Jesus said, I only speak what I hear Father say. He says to the leper, what? I want to. Will, Phalo, I want to. I want to. Here, heal your heart. I'm healing your heart. The leprosy was secondary. When they lowered the boy through the roof, they plopped him down in front of the Lord. There he is. What's the obvious problem? Oh, he's paralyzed. That's the obvious problem? It wasn't the obvious problem. This kid hated himself. He hated his life. He carried around guilt and shame. Jesus never even focused on the healing. He focused, son, be of good cheer. Your sins are forgiven you. What was he doing there? Like he'd done the leper. He went for the heart first. He heard Father saying, I only speak what I hear Father saying. He could hear Father when the rest of us couldn't. He knew that boy's heart was broken. He knew he had been in torment. He knew he hated himself. He knew he wanted to die. Though he had that thought many times. He wanted to die. Who wouldn't, a quadriplegic, want to die all the time? I had a friend of mine who was a quadriplegic. He told him, listen, take me off this respirator. I'm done. He couldn't take it anymore. He's tired of watching TV. Tired of being cared for. That kid on that cot was much sicker than quadriplegia. The Greek word is paralyticus. He was paralyzed. Quadriplegia, can be argued, is worse than blindness. Much worse, depending on your argument. The first thing he focused on was right in there. Why would he do that? Let's think about it. Here's what blocks the miracles. It's not here. You read the story, you heard the sermon. It gets blocked here. Depression, sadness, sorrow, misery, shame, guilt blocks your healing. Bitterness, frustration, anger, unforgiveness blocks your healing. Self-pity, self-hatred, self-criticism, low self-esteem blocks the miracle from God. That leper needed more than a healing from leprosy. In his mind, hello? In his mind, that's what he thought he needed. God knows what you need when you don't. Sometimes the sickness is secondary. If you don't believe me, if you've ever worked with an addict, you know exactly what I'm saying. The addiction is always a secondary issue. It's never primary. It's always something in here. this guy was delivered, and the miracle he needed was incredible. His situation was utterly, utterly impossible. Incredibly impossible. Leprosy tears the person down to nothing. Their digits fall off, their ears fall off, their skin falls off their body. It's a hideous illness. Here's a patient that's losing digits from leprosy. Final stages of it take your vision, your whole body starts to decay. You're like a walking corpse. The miracle that occurred there that day had to have been astronomical to see. Here's a child with leprosy. You can see how it eats away your skin. It removes all of your digits. This healing must have been shocking. Shocking healing for God. So see this man instantly cured in front of everybody. We had a lot of testimonies here tonight. No offense. This one's a little kind of an upgrade. This was huge. You got digits popping back on your hands? Man, that's a creative miracle. Your skin turns into a baby's bottom? Have you ever seen a baby's bottom? Any parents out there? Yeah. I was a mom dad when I was young and had my two daughters. One of them is listening right now, so I'll talk about the other one that's not listening. My firstborn daughter, I used to watch her while I was going to college. And her mother worked as a nurse. So I'd watch the kids do my homework while she was at work. You know, typical college situation. I was married in college, right? Well, I got tired of taking care of kids. And I started to learn shortcuts. Yeah. Because I got this thing. It's huge in there. Huge. So I thought, well, you know, I can save some time bathing my oldest daughter. She was just a teeny type back then. Year, whatever, less year. I said, I'll just take her in the shower when I'm showering. See? Plus, I'll save water. Worked great. Scoop up the kid, headed in the shower. Soaping her up. Huh? I'm cleaning her up. I lift her legs up. I roll her around. It was literally like a car wash. You ever seen that? I take her out of the shower. She's so clean you can't even believe it. Put down the cloth, dry her off, put her there, grab the baby powder. Nobody knows how to do this? I'm it? I should open up a clinic. Roll her over. Then I would pat her bottom. I don't know why. It was so soft. Have you ever seen baby bottom? It's the softest thing known to man. Baby bottom. And then when you got a little talcum powder, what do they call that? What's that called? Baby powder. Put them in there. It's like you're skating. It's like, and she feels good, I feel good. It's great. Can you imagine going from that to that in seconds? Boy, that's a Holy Ghost moving there. But more importantly, can you imagine the Holy Ghost healing this first? You know why it's so important to get this healed first? Why he talked to that kid on the cot first here? You know why? The devil can steal your healing from you. If you don't renew your mind and you don't change your heart, you can lose a healing. I have talked to people personally, numerous ones, who have done it. If you get your heart healed and renew your mind, You will never lose your healing. Not in a million years. You can face the impossible here when you can't face it here physically. You know what you're going to do tonight? You're going to get your heart healed. And you're going to get the rest of you healed. You know God can heal you. You know God can heal you. But he wanted to know, do you want to heal me? He had that doubt, see, in the back of his mind. Do you want to heal me? Every one of you, me included, have faced or are facing right now impossible odds. Impossible odds. Your chances are zero to nothing in some area of your life. This isn't a word of faith thing here. We don't do that here. You don't just keep repeating the scripture over, try and talk yourself into it. No, this is a spiritual thing from your spirit, man. You know you should have been healed a long time ago. But something was blocking it. Something's blocking it. Something's blocking your healing. And the Lord's going to tell you right now, Father, in the name of Jesus, I'm asking you right now to reveal this secret to your children right this second. I want you to reveal this secret. What little lie, what little falsehood, what little thought did the devil put in there that's blocking their healing right now? I want you to reveal it to him. Let's just take 60 seconds here. Ministry team, get ready to go here. Just take 1 second here. Something's blocking your healing. Something's blocking your tears. Something's blocking your repentance. Something's blocking, and you're facing an impossible situation. You now know God can heal you, and you now know he wants to heal you. We just read it. But something in your heart, what you need is a touch before you get healed. It's emotional. It's spiritual. It's something inside. It's old abuse. It's an old spouse. It's somebody that stabbed you in the back. It's somebody that stole money from you. It's somebody who keeps hurting you. It's the government. It's the Social Security. It's the system that has hurt you. You got bad, bitter feelings about the system, the government, the man. You have bitterness in your heart, disgust for them. You feel disgusted for someone or something. You feel disgusted. You feel disgusted for a doctor who didn't treat you properly. You feel disgusted for your ex-spouse who ran off with this and lied about that. Something inside is hurting you. And that's going to block your healing. And God wants you to get up off the cot tonight, pick up your cot, and go home to your family and heal them. You notice he sent that boy home? Why? The Lord Jesus wanted his family healed. kid went home with a healed heart and a healed body, and he told him to go home, not go preach on the street corner. Notice that? He sent him home. He didn't have to tell the leper that, because that's the first place he knew he'd go. Back to see his children he hadn't seen in years. With two things: his heart was healed, his body was healed. You know what it is now. Just wave at me if you had a revelation of it. Anybody at all get a revelation of something in your heart? 1, 2, 3, 4, only 6, that's it? I better pray again. Father, 6 people raised their hand that you gave them a word in their mind, and you told them something in there was blocking their healing. Okay? Something in there is blocking their healing. Now I'm going to pray in one more time. That's going to be it. What is it? What is it? What's blocking it? What is it? What is it? Frustration, anger, bitterness, sadness, blaming yourself for something, being hard on yourself, got a critical spirit, nagging people, nagging yourself, resentful to God, bitter toward God, not forgiving others, not loving others. What is that? What's the trigger? The trigger. You see, it's easy to get healed and easy to get delivered from demons. The hard part is the heart. The heart is the hard part. What is it? Right now. What is it now? Okay. Let's try it again. Just wave at me if you got some thought came into your mind. You know what's blocking what you're doing. 3. Okay, that's more. Good. All right, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Something's blocking you. Now, if you have a mental illness, like bipolar or something, I already know what's blocking you. Those are thoughts, okay? Most of you are not mentally ill here, a vast majority of you, okay? So that's not it. If you're mentally ill, it's thoughts. That's always it. All right, let's pray. Father God, in the name of Jesus, I just realized what was wrong with me. I realized there was something in my soul, like the boy on the cot, like that dying leper. And what I need tonight, Lord, I need a touch. I need a touch before I'm healed. I need a touch before I'm healed. I need him to touch me and my soul before I'm healed. And I must remove this from my soul tonight. I have to do it. I cannot live another month, not another week, with this in my heart. I went through the forgiveness seminar. I went through the forgiveness prayers. But when I think about that person, I still have negative feelings and emotions come up about that person. I still have these regrets coming up about me. I still have these negative feelings, these emotions about myself, about my ex, about my current spouse. He or she's driving me crazy. They're not serving God, and I want them to. I tried my best to fix them, and I can't. My heart is hurting because I can't fix my spouse. And the devil's now hurting me over it. He's using my spouse to get to me. Now I'm going to repent of it right this second. By faith, supernaturally, I'm going to release these things to the Lord tonight. I'm going to receive my touch like that dying leper received his. All right, now if you waved at me, just come right up here to the front. I want to pray with you tonight, okay? Did you wave at me? Come up here so we can get that thing out of there. so you can leave healed. Right? Just come right up right now. Did you wave at me earlier? You got a thought in your head, got a thought in your mind telling you, hey, I got a little something against somebody. I've got this thing clicked in my mind that has to go, and I know it's not of God. That thing has to come out of there. That thought has to come out of there. Thank you, Jesus. Anybody else? If you need to leave, you're dismissed. God bless you. And thank you for coming tonight. We might have an announcement coming here pretty shortly. We thank you for your prayers and your donations and all you've done for us. You have accomplished this thing. I thank you for it. Okay? We'll bring my ministry team up now real quickly. Anybody else, you had a thought? Holy Spirit spoke to you just a couple minutes ago while I was praying, and there's something in your soul. Okay? It's not the healing you need. It's the soul healing you need first. Jesus went there first. First. Okay? You need a soul healing first. Thank you, Jesus. You need a soul healing first. Okay? And it could be a simple thing. You know, regretting something you did. It just kind of gnaws at you. And the devil will use that regret on you. He'll grind it. He grinds it slowly in your soul. He uses bad choices you made against you. Yeah, you shouldn't have dated her. You shouldn't have gone out with him. You shouldn't have taken that job. You shouldn't have gone here or there. And it lodges in here, in the soul. He plants those seeds of internal discord to block your healing later, to block your ministry, to block your anointing. That's how he does it. No offense, but the devil's a lot smarter than we are. Much smarter. He's playing chess, we're playing checkers. But he's not smarter than the Holy Ghost. Not by a long shot. That little seed the devil planted in there when you were abused when you were young, that little rejection, that little self-disgust when you were a kid, you know that stays with you your entire life unless the Holy Spirit removes it? It never leaves. See, you weren't drinking and using drugs because you were drinking and using drugs. No, 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 no. It was what he put in there. The devil planted it in there. My dad hates me. My dad hates me. He planted that hate from your dad right in there. He did it for a reason. He's smarter than we are. He thinks. But tonight he'll have to let you go. Because you're going to release that little thing the devil put in you. When you got raped, you got beat up, you got used, you got yelled at, verbally abused. Remember that? That was the devil. It wasn't your mother and dad doing it. It was the devil using them to plant that seed right in there. Lord Jesus, please forgive me. Close your eyes. God, please forgive me. Sweet Holy Spirit, I'm so sorry. I've carried this stuff around with me for years. I was in an abusive relationship, not for a couple of weeks, for years. I wasn't verbally abused two or three times. It went on for years. Years. The devil told me I was worthless. I was useless. I was no good. He taught me how to use drugs and alcohol and food to comfort my soul. It was a trick. It was a trick. He told me how to use sex and porn to give me an escape from the sickness in my soul. Jesus touched that leper. He just touched him like that and healed his soul first. You in a bad marriage, a horrible marriage? That's the devil using your spouse to destroy your faith and eat your soul alive. He's using that person to beat you down. He's using that person to hurt you, and you must forgive them right now. Father, right now, in the name of Jesus Christ. Just mention their name. Just whisper it out. The Bible requires you to confess it. Just say it. That person that stabbed you right in the back. Just mention their name quickly. Just mention their name. Lord Jesus, I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry. I took an offense against that person. You were in a long-term marriage and it went to hell in a handbasket. It was horrible. And that person wounded you beyond belief. And you're carrying them wounds now in that soul right there. You're carrying them wounds. You know why? You fought for years. You fought. There was strife in your home, and that opened the door to demons. Strife in the house opens the door to demons. Arguing and fighting opens the door to demons. The demons then take the children. Your children then become infected. Then they turn out worse than you were. They turn out sicker than you were. You help them get sick. You help them pick up demons. You've got pet sins in your life you've never released right now. You're going to release them right this second. Father, in Jesus' mighty name, I command this deep-seated wound in my soul to come out now. I want it out now in the name of Jesus. At any cost, I want it out right now.
At any cost.
Come out right now in the name of the Lord. At any cost, every ugly man that ever touched my body or used my body, every ugly man, come out right now. Get out of that body right now. Doubt and unbelief, pride and arrogance, come out right now in Jesus' mighty name. Holy Spirit, help me right now. Holy Spirit, help me right now. Holy Spirit, help me right now. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Satan, loose your hold right now. Loose your hold right now. Loose your hold of my body. Loose my mind. Loose my soul. Right this second. Adultery and fornication. Come out of my body right now. Pornography and masturbation. Come out of my body right now. Arguing and fighting. Come out of my body right now. Come out of my soul. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Come out right this second. Satan, I bind your power. Witchcraft and sorcery, I bind your power. Drugs. Drugs, I bind your power. Insecurity. Come out in Jesus' mighty name. Low self-esteem. Come out in the name of Jesus Christ. Come out in Jesus' mighty name. Unbelief and doubt. I curse you. Come out. Unbelief and doubt. Come out of that body right now. Come out. Satan, loose your hold of me right now. Come out right now. Satan, loose your hold. Lust, I bind your power. Lust, come out. Right now. Come out in Jesus' mighty name. The Holy Ghost is moving. Reach out and take your miracle. Reach out and take your miracle. The Holy Ghost is moving. Anything can happen with Him here. Anything can happen in Jesus' mighty name. Come on. Just repent of it. Just confess it. I command that coward spirit to come out of you. I command shyness to come out of you right now. Shyness. You are shy. That is a coward spirit. God has not given us a spirit of fear. That Greek word for fear is dalia. It means cowardice. You are a spiritual coward. Repent of it right now. Come on, let's go. Come on, let's go. You are a spiritual coward. Fight back now. Satan, I bind your power by faith. Come out of me. Satan, come out of me. Every ugly man that ever touched my body, come out of my stomach, come out of my womb. Come out of my genitals right now. Come out now. Go in Jesus' holy name. Right now. Shyness, come out. Shyness, come out. Come out in Jesus' mighty name. Come on, ladies. Let's get rid of every man you ever dated. Every man you ever dated. Come on. Manipulation, narcissism, lust, sexual perversion, anal sex, oral sex. Those transfer spirits, come out now. Come out now. Jesus, the Son of God. Come out right now. Come out right now.
Take a breath and look.
Come out right now. Go. Come out of there. All of it.
So sorry, Father.
All of it. Come out.
My mind hasn't been stayed.
All of it.
No peace. I've got anxiety.
All of it. Come out right now. All of it. Come out right now. Quicker. Come out quicker. All of it. Come out. All of it. Come out. Shyness. Come out right now. Unbelief and doubt. Come out right now. Go. Go now. Go now. Go now. I want him out of my body right now. I want him out. Get him out of there. Come out. Come on, ladies. Every old boyfriend, out. Every boyfriend, out. Every child that betrayed you and stabbed you in the back, out. Out. There goes. What's in there? Who is he?
Anger.
When did it start?
My whole life.
Your dad?
No, anger.
Bitterness. Who hurt you?
Girls in the past.
Girls. Okay, thank you, Jesus. Lord, see this brother right here? He's supposed to be a faith healer. He's wasting his life. The demons sent him a bunch of women with demons. And he planted them in his life because he knew they were going to turn on him. And then he knew he was going to get bitter. And then when he got bitter, his life was over. But tonight he's taking his life back. Every ugly woman, every one of them, come out. Every one of them. They were all plants. Come out in Jesus' name. There he is. Come out. Here he comes. Come out. Come out. Let your tears go. Let your tears go. Every woman goes. Every woman goes. Come on, ladies. Come on, you got to get this stuff out of you. You got to do it now. Do not leave here tonight carrying this crap in your soul. Let's go. The Spirit of the Lord is here. He's moving right now. He's moving right now. Go in Jesus' mighty name. Let's go now. Let's go now. Repent. Just repent. Just repent of it. What's wrong with you? What's wrong with you?
The word that's coming to mind right now is lying.
Why are you lying?
Repent of it.
Why are you lying?
I don't have any idea.
There's an emotional reason for it. Think about it. Somebody picking on you.
I've lied in the past, and I've believed lies.
When did that start?
When I was a kid, fetus.
Your dad or your mom?
Both of them.
Mom?
Both of them.
Both of them. What were their names?
Kathy and Bert.
Okay. Now just relax for a second. Relax. Take a big breath. Lord, this beautiful woman here is severely damaged in her soul. She got beat as a kid, and the demons caught her to get out of trouble by lying. They taught her to make herself look or feel better by lying. They taught her to improve her self-esteem, which was low, by lying to others. This lying spirit took her mind when she was little. And tonight we're going to release both parents from her soul. They don't belong in there. Only the Holy Ghost belongs in here. Go. There you go. Both my parents, I release them now.
I release both my parents now.
Both my parents. Both my parents come out now. Both my parents come out now. Come on. I repent of lying. Thus saith the Lord, thou shalt not lie. For I'm lying for a reason. What's the root of lying? What's the root of lying? The root of it. You do it for a reason. You lie for a reason. What is it?
Fear.
Fear. Fear is based on unbelief and doubt.
I repent of unbelief and doubt.
You don't believe God. You don't trust Him. You don't trust God. You don't believe Him. That causes fear.
I'm not walking that way anymore, Lord. I'm letting you go.
Now, you're letting me go now. Unbelief, doubt.
I come out of a I say, be cast.
Hiding behind lies. Hiding behind lies.
And you're too much.
What's wrong with him?
Yeah, in the last 2 weeks, he started crying and crying and crying. And he got his anguish and anxiety. And he doesn't want to go to the school.
Yeah.
And then he had a stomach pain. He went to the emergency room. And he saw his appendix. And what happened? It was like a fracture. So he sees. But the thing is that he cries too much. He cries and doesn't want to go to the school. He said that he missed me. He missed Ryan, the other brother.
Why are you crying all the time?
Because I miss them.
You miss who?
My mom and my brother.
You miss your mom and your brother? Are they gone?
No, I just go to school.
And you miss your mom and your brother while you're at school? Is that what you're saying?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Come on over here. Hey. Now, how's everything going at home?
Good.
Is it good? Are your parents fighting at home?
No.
No? Are you afraid of something at home? Nothing? Are you afraid of being away from your mom? When you're at school crying, is it because you're afraid? Why are you crying if you're at school? And what are you afraid of?
I just feel afraid of something.
Okay. Now, that's probably a spirit. You know what a demon is? They kind of look like that. They kind of look like that right there. Demons can get in your body. They're called fear demons. And they usually hang around in this area right here. And did you know that you can cast him out of there?
Yeah.
You did? Okay. Here, turn around. Now, when you have fear, where do you feel it at?
Here.
Okay. Where else? Up here? Here? Where?
Here.
Okay. Put your hand right here. Put that hand there. Close your eyes. Now tell that spirit of fear to come out of you right now. In the name of Jesus Christ, I command you, spirit of fear, to come out of my body right now. Get out of my body right this second. Come out now. Okay, take a breath and blow. Blow like that. Come out. Come out, spirit. Keep blowing. There he is. Keep coughing. Come out. Good. Come out. Come out of him. Keep blowing. Come out. Go.
Hello.
School fear. Come out. There he is. Keep coughing. There he comes. He's coming out right now. There he is. Go. Fear, come out. Go. Come out. Go. 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 There he comes. Good. Next one. Go. Come out. Come out, go. 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 Come out. Come out. Come out of there. Come out, hurry. There he is. Next one. Come out. Good. Next. Devil, come out. Quickly. Quicker. Quicker. All the demons from the mother and dad, come out. Go now. All the demons of strife, come out. Anger, out. Frustration, out. Loneliness, out. Go. 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 There he is. Out. Come out of his brain right now. Quickly. There he comes. Good. Good. Come out. Good. Get out of my body right now, devil. Fear, come out of me. Fear, come out now. Go now. Go. Come out. Go. Leave. Sickness, come out. Go. Sickness. Spirits from my family tree, come out. Go. Go. Out. I am not afraid of school anymore. I am not lonely anymore. Now come out. Go. In Jesus' name, go. Out.
Every spirit of fear right now inside.
How are you feeling right now? Good. Okay, are you afraid now? Is it gone? Okay. Love you.
She's got a testimony.
You got a testimony?
Yeah.
Is that mic on?
Yeah,
go ahead. What's your name?
My name is Dolores, and this is my second time being here. And the first time that I came here, I had healing done to me.
What healing?
Victoria. And I had a lot going on. I was going through a divorce, and I moved all the way here to Michigan, to Arizona, which is 2,800 miles. And my children were living with their dad, and I thought that I was never going to get to see them again. And my son especially, because I had a special relationship with him. And so I never thought I was going to see any of my children again. But tonight here I have my oldest daughter. She came first. And now my son just came last week. And he's going to school and he's going to be graduating. And I'm going to have my two daughters come visit me this summer. And I've been in Arizona for 6 months.
It means you better start fighting right now.
I'm taking too much antibiotics now.
You're what?
Antibiotics. I'm taking too much antibiotics. Only infection, but there's infection. There's other infection, but other infection. Several.
And Tori's right now. Oh, she's right here.
Okay. So I don't know if this is something spiritual or is it like my brother?
Probably.
Okay. Can you give us just a testimony
probably
right now
spiritual.
Of what's going on with you, Tony? Extremely.
Probably.
Right.
Now, Satan, I command you in the name of Jesus to let my wife go right now. I command you in the name of the Lord.
And I can see the color of yellow.
Say that. I command you in the name of Jesus Christ. I command this demonic infection to come out of that body right this second.
Sunshine.
And leave that body. I command you, Satan, to loose her.
Yeah, I can see your hand moving when you hear.
Right now, in the name of the Lord.
No.
Loose her right now.
I can see the color yellow.
And be healed.
Folks, Tony has been diagnosed with
Jesus'
mighty
name.
She came
Jesus
into agreement with what the
be
doctor
healed.
Told her.
Right now.
And she said,
be healed.
I really believe what he told
Lord,
me.
Mike,
but
I
now,
for,
as she's releasing the doctor and all those lies that
yeah.
he told her, she's getting healing back into those eyes. She's seeing movement. When we move our hands over her eyes, she can see shadows, and she can also see
start?
The color yellow. So we've got more work to do. They're not out yet, Tony.
Yeah,
but I know that Father is restoring her sight completely and whole. Amen. We're going to have more testimony from Tony for you, so hang tight.
Anything wrong with you before that?
Well, I had a bad relationship with my father, but everything's okay now. I learned to forgive. So.
Okay. What'd your dad do to you?
Oh, no, he just, like, walked away from the family, basically.
Oh, he abandoned you?
Yeah.
How old were you?
Like, 14, 15.
Okay, and then before that, did anything bad happen to you?
No. We were always, like, a family together.
You what?
We were always, like, a good family together.
Yeah.
You know?
Did you ever have any trauma or injuries or anything like that when you were little?
No.
No? Nothing?
Nothing.
Okay. Did you have any anxiety or fear as a kid?
Just my family split
up. No, that was when you were a teenager.
The fear before that?
Oh, we had it before that.
It was always kind of like my parents were always fighting.
Oh, they were always fighting. Okay, that's it. All right, now that's it. Now here's what happened to you. You pinpointed it. What happens is the devil sends the same demon to every dysfunctional family. It's the spirit of rejection. And this spirit gets into the kid's head. And he starts to let in other spirits. And one of them was a fear demon. And you start developing childhood anxiety. Because they kept fighting, and the kids don't understand that. They get scared, and they think their parents are going to, they have all kinds of wild thoughts from the devil. And so that spirit that got in there, later on, triggered.
It's mostly drugs. Pills, rather than drinking. No, that. Just pills.
He triggered it.
And then, of course, like, before, I was always, like, into the gym and stuff. And little by little, this got short. Little by little. That's what it was.
What showed up?
This. Just to do with drugs and cigarettes. Poisons to the body. Toxins. Overload. The body's trying to detox itself. It can because you're taking drugs and cigarettes.
But the root of you taking the drugs in, what were you get? What benefit were you getting out of it?
Escape, temporary escape.
See what I mean? That's a rejection demon.
The truth is, you don't think about anything that's happening. You're in love.
Yeah.
And then you come back out in reality.
Right. From him, from childhood. That's the guy.
But everything's okay with my parents now.
Doesn't matter. He already got in.
The trouble's already there. Right?
Doesn't matter. You follow me?
I follow you.
Okay, let's try and get him out of there. Come on over here so nobody can see you.
What about the little bucket?
Yeah, it's right there. Close your eyes. Now just take a big breath. What was your name?
Ray.
Oh, good. Thank you, Jesus. Father, I got Ray here, and he loves you. He cares about you. He wants to serve you. But unfortunately, his arguing, fighting, strife-ridden parents are still in his soul. He already forgave them, and he already made it up to them, and that part of it, you've already fixed, but this part here is not fixed. The spirit of rejection that hit him when he was a kid and let this lust demon in for drugs and alcohol, sex, all of it, the whole business. It's torturing him today. And he wants him out of there tonight. Father, in the name of Jesus, I want you to remove his arguing, screaming parents out of his soul. All right, take a breath. Hello? Dad, I love you, but you must leave my soul now. Keep blowing. Mom, I love you, but you now must leave. Nothing's going to remain in me but the Holy Ghost. Low self-esteem, childhood fear, come out of my body and my soul right now. Demon of drugs, I bind your power. I curse you, pills. I curse you, pills. Come out of there. Unclean spirit, come out of my body right now in the name of the Lord Jesus. I bind your power and I command you to come out of my body right now. Childhood fear, come out of there. Stop jumping and come out. Stop jumping in there and come out right now. I want you out of my body right this second. Come out. Get out of my body, I said. Father, I need you to give him the gift of hate right now. He doesn't understand. This demon is going to give him a terminal illness later in life. We cannot have that. You unclean spirit, we bind your power in Jesus' name. Jesus said you cannot serve two masters. You must hate one of them. And now we hate you. He hates you. He hates drugs. He hates alcohol. He hates sin. He hates wasting his life. He hates living like a spiritual loser. He hates it. And he commands you right now in no uncertain terms. You come out of his body now. Come out. There he comes. Come out. Hey, don't leave. Hold that. Come out right now. Keep coughing. Come out. There he is. Come out. Come out of that body right now. Come out, spirit. He hates you now. Come out now. Come out now, I said. Hurry up. Come out of that body right now. Come out right now. Come out, he said. You cannot serve two masters anymore. You must hate one of them. You don't hate those pills. Father, give him hate for those pills. He doesn't hate the alcohol. Give him hate for it. I hate it. Come out right now. I said I hate it. Here he comes. Here he comes. There he comes. Come out. Let him out. There he is right there. He's coming out right now. There he comes. He's in your stomach. Come out, spirit. Come out, spirit. Hurry up. Get out of that stomach right now. Come out of there right now. Go. There he is. Keep coughing. Come out right now. There he comes now. Go. Go in the name of the Lord. Go in Jesus' mighty name. Poison from pills. Come out. Poison. Poison. Come out now. Go. Poison. Come out right now. Get out of that body right this second. There he comes. Son, it's coming up right now. This is your chance to be healed. Take it. I hate pills. I hate alcohol. I hate sin. Come out of me. Come out of me. I'm not going to die an addict. I'm not going to die an addict. Come out. There he is. Here he comes. You foul spirit of addiction. Come out in Jesus' mighty name. Come out of his pores. Come out of his body. Come out of his blood. Come out of there. Right now. Come out of his feet. Come out of his head. Right now. In Jesus' name. Every argument his parents went through as a child. Come out now. Go. Come out now in Jesus' mighty name. There it is. Come on, son. You got the anointing. Take it. There it is. He's coming up right now. Good. You got the anointing. Go. Come out. Come out of there. Go. Come out. Come out. Addiction, you come out now. Go. Pills, you come out.
Alcohol, lust, pornography, everything, come out of my body. Poison, come out. Come out of my genitals right now. I command you in Jesus' name. Come out of there, you pervert. There he comes. There it is right there.
Looking at all the nakedness.
Good.
Pornography.
Go.
Homosexuality that came in.
Go.
Looking at those guys.
Come out.
Sex, those threesomes, those foursomes, lesbian sex.
Come out.
Come out. Spirits that came in the eyes.
Go now. There he comes.
Yeah,
there he comes. He's coming out now. Big one. Coming out now. Fight harder. Fight harder. Fight harder. Come out in Jesus' name. Fight harder. Hi, sweetheart.
So when we're talking
about
your
background. Yeah.
Yeah.
So somebody watching here know you?
Yeah. I work for a pretty big Christian university.
Oh, you do?
I do.
Okay.
Is your mic on?
No, let me turn it off. Satan, you get out of that body right now. Don't you dare. Don't you dare stop. Come out right now. Come out quicker. Come out quicker. Come out quicker. Come out quicker. I want every spirit out of me tonight, no matter what. Any spirit. Every spirit. Right now. Every negative thought. Every lie. Come out of my head. Right now. Every low thought of self-esteem. Every negative thought I've hated about myself. Hating myself. There it comes right there. Hating myself. Good. Go now.
Go, 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 go,